This episode of Food Psych is brought to you by MM LaFleur. Want to look impeccable at the office but have better things to do than shop for workwear? MM LaFleur is a women's workwear brand that offers luxurious, pragmatic clothing and personal styling in both straight sizes and plus sizes. Just fill out a quick online survey and one of their discerning stylists will send you a bento box of wardrobe staples handpicked just for you. Try everything on at home, keep what you like, and send back the rest. It's totally free to try and they're not a subscription service, so there's no commitment. To try a bento yourself, visit mmbento.com. That's mmbento.com. Use the code PSYCH, P-S-Y-C-H, at checkout, and MM LaFleur will donate 10% of profits to global giving. Welcome to Food Psych, a podcast about intuitive eating, health at every size, and body liberation. I'm your host, Christy Harrison, and I'm an anti-diet registered dietitian and certified intuitive eating counselor, offering online courses and programs to help people all over the world make peace with food. Join me here every week as I talk with interesting people from all walks of life about their relationships with food and their bodies.
I remember I was teething, little gums bleeding, Friday evening, it was all about eating. When I became a teen, it was all about beef, and now I'm ready for the world.
Hey there, welcome to episode 138 of Food Psych. I'm your host, Christy Harrison, and today I'm talking with Sarah Harry, who's a psychotherapist, yoga teacher, and the author of the book Fat Yoga. We discussed how to handle fat phobia in the family, how diet culture drives eating disorders, fat phobia in the fashion industry, the complications of weight loss surgery for her, the role of yoga in diet culture recovery, and so much more. It's a really great episode, and I can't wait to share it with you in just a moment. But first, I'm going to answer this week's listener question, which is from a listener named, or with initials KMH, who writes, I've been doing intuitive eating for several months after a little over a decade of disordered eating. Most of my disorder was related to restriction, but for the last 2 years of it, I began cycling between restriction and binge eating. A few months after starting intuitive eating, my binge urges decreased significantly as I allowed myself any and all foods. Though I've only had one full-blown binge since starting my recovery, I've had times of overeating emotionally with awareness and felt the urge to binge. I know it's unrealistic to expect that the binges will stop completely, and I've been very compassionate with myself through most of those stumbles. But I recently had a bad binge that triggered me to severely restrict afterward. I just couldn't get my mind out of the punishment mode and befriend myself. Also, just FYI, I'm working with a therapist to examine the emotional components behind my poor relationship with food. I would like to know, either through your personal experience, research, or both, if intuitive eating can eliminate binge behaviors with time and practice. Also, how can a person best work through binge relapses while learning to eat intuitively? Thank you so much. So thanks, KMH, for that great question. And before I answer, just my usual disclaimer, these answers are for informational and educational purposes only and aren't a substitute for individual medical or mental health advice. So yeah, this is a really common thing that I've seen a lot in my practice as a dietitian and intuitive eating coach, and that I also went through in my own recovery, so you're definitely not alone here. The short answer is that yes, intuitive eating can definitely help you stop binging, but not necessarily in the way you might expect. See, focusing on eliminating binges and making that the problem really misses the underlying cause and the reason that you got into a pattern of binging in the first place. And I'm not talking about the emotional reasons here. I'm talking about restriction, which is really the underlying cause of the binging on a physiological level. So to help with the binging, you actually need to stop focusing on the binging behavior itself and start focusing on the restrictive behaviors and the mindset of restriction. You need to work on completely giving up restriction and stop being restrictive after binges to compensate, which I know is hard. And it sounds like you were in a particularly tough place there and you weren't being very compassionate with yourself. So you fell back on old ways, which is to be expected in difficult moments. And that will dissipate over time. You will get stronger and stronger at being compassionate with yourself over time. But just know that the ultimate goal here, you know, if you can make the goal be, instead of I have to stop the binges, make the goal be I have to stop the restriction. I'm going to work towards that. And I'm going to work towards completely giving it up even after a binge. That's what's really going to help. Because when you restrict yourself, whether it's physically or mentally or both, and by the way, for most people, it is both, it's some of both at least, you set yourself up to binge because your body thinks it's in a famine. And through the process of evolution, the human body really evolved to respond to famine by increasing your hunger hormones and keeping them elevated, right? So they don't go down after a meal, decreasing the hormones that signal fullness, and increasing your cravings for the kinds of foods that will help you survive the famine, which is in particular high carbohydrate foods to get your energy levels up quickly, which is why a lot of people's binge foods tend to be sweets and starches and things like that. So I want to stress here that these are temporary changes that result from dieting and restrictive eating, and that they're not anything you have to do something about. You don't have to go on a special diet to, like, quote unquote, reset your body, right? In fact, the way to get your body's natural hunger and fullness cues to fall back into place is to stop dieting and stop restricting, right? To let go and to give up the diet mentality and just allow yourself to have unconditional permission to eat whatever you want and as much as you want. So I call the restrict binge cycle that you're seeming to be in the restriction pendulum. Because when you think about a pendulum, you know, you pull it back all the way to one side, you can't expect that it'll then just magically stop in the middle, right? And just sort of be centered all of a sudden. When you pull a pendulum back, it's going to swing all the way to the other side with equal force. And it's going to keep swinging back and forth, and maybe at smaller intervals until it finally gets to the resting point in the middle where it is stable. So you can expect that to be the case with a restrict binge cycle. You were in this place before of, like, severely pulling the pendulum back and having it swing way over to the side of restriction. And now you're not doing that as much anymore. And you're noticing that you are ending up more in the center most of the time. I would look for the ways in which you pulled the pendulum back when you have a binge like that. Were there ways that you were restricting emotionally, physically, or both? Probably both. And that might be the key, the reason why you ended up far on the other side with a binge. And then it sounds like you went back to the side of restriction, right? You swung back to the other side that you started at by severely restricting yourself after the binge. And so that's not really the way that's going to lead to calming down in the middle. The more you can let go of the restriction and not swing so far to that restrictive side of the pendulum, the quicker you will end up settling in the middle. So just try to think about it that way next time you're tempted to restrict in the face of a binge. That's actually the way to keep the binge restrict cycle going, right? That's not the way to end up settling and centered and calm in the middle. So the process of intuitive eating can really be tricky, I will say, when you're coming from the background of a restrictive eating disorder. And it's great that you're working with a therapist. That's awesome. But I'd really recommend working with an intuitive eating dietitian as well, because they can help you with the food piece of it. You know, they can help you create a meal plan if you need one. They can help you tune in better to your hunger and fullness cues. You know, all the nuances of the food stuff that might not be coming up in your therapy sessions, right? And that an intuitive eating dietitian is really equipped to handle. So you can find one by going to intuitiveeating.org and clicking on certified counselors. And we'll put that link in the show notes for this episode on the website as well so that you can find it there. I also just want to give you a lot of compassion and some serious props for working on showing yourself more compassion, because that really is so important in the process of recovery, so important in the process of freeing yourself from the restrictive mindset. And so it's amazing that you've been able to do that yourself, right? And there are definitely going to be slips and hard parts on the path to recovery. So give yourself compassion for that. This one slip doesn't mean a slide, right? It doesn't mean you're backsliding. It just means you had a little hiccup, you know, and now you can get back to it. So there are definitely going to be those moments in recovery, right? But if you can be compassionate with yourself and be curious with yourself during those moments and sort of find out, okay, what do I think led to this binge? What do I think led me to really clamp down and severely restrict afterwards? Be curious, be open, try to figure out ways to prevent this stuff from happening again. These moments of slipping can actually help lead to a lot of growth. So thanks so much for that question, and I hope that helps. And if you want to submit a question of your own for a chance to have it answered on an upcoming episode, go to christyharrison.com/questions. That's christyharrison.com/questions. We're brought to you today by M.M. Lafleur. For the woman who wants to look impeccable at work but has better things to do than sift through uninspiring racks of pantsuits, the solution is M.M. Lafleur. They take the work out of dressing for work by offering luxurious, pragmatic clothing and personal styling in both straight sizes and plus sizes, which is why I love them. Just fill out a quick online survey, and one of their discerning stylists will send you a bento box of wardrobe staples handpicked just for you based on your preferences and lifestyle. Once your bento arrives, you have 4 days to try everything on. Then keep what you like and send the rest back. You won't be charged anything up front, and you only pay for the items you keep. It's completely free to try, and even shipping is free both ways. And because it's not a subscription service, there's no commitment. To try a bento yourself, visit mmbento.com. That's mmbento.com. And use the code PSYCH, P-S-Y-C-H, at checkout, and MM LaFleur will donate 10% of profits to Global Giving. We're also brought to you today by Casper Mattress. With three mattress models, the original Casper, the Wave, and the Essential, Casper mattresses are perfectly designed to soothe and cradle your body. Not to mention, the breathable design helps you sleep cool and regulates your body temperature throughout the night. And it's delivered right to your door in an amazingly small box with free shipping and free returns in the US and Canada. But the best part is that you can be sure of your purchase with Casper's 100-night risk-free sleep on it trial. My husband and I have had a Casper for going on 2 years now, and I actually bought it after hearing about it on a podcast ad because at the time we had a different mattress and we were sleeping terribly and waking up with all kinds of back and neck pain. And as soon as we got the Casper, I started falling asleep instantly and waking up so much more rested and without any pain. It's hands down the best mattress I've ever owned, and sleep is so important for self-care that now I really recommend this to everyone. After all, you spend 1/3 of your life sleeping, so you should really be comfortable. Start sleeping ahead of the curve with Casper. Get $50 towards any mattress purchase by visiting casper.com/psych, that's P-S-Y-C-H, and using the offer code PSYCH at checkout. That's casper.com/psych, and use the offer code PSYCH for $50 off your mattress purchase. Terms and conditions apply. This episode is also brought to you by Audible. Audiobooks are great for helping you be your best self, whether you want to improve your well-being, get passionate about a topic, or learn something new. And with an unmatched selection of audiobooks, original audio shows, news, comedy, and more, Audible has all the audio content you need to start your year off right. They've got so much awesome anti-diet literature that will help you resist the onslaught of diet culture this time of year, including tons of great books from past podcast guests like Intuitive Eating by Evelyn Triboli and Elise Resch, Shrill by Lindy West, Body of Truth by Harriet Brown, Big Girl by Kelsey Miller, Things No One Will Tell Fat Girls by Jess Baker, and so many more. Whether it's on your phone, through your car, or at home on the Amazon Echo, you can listen to all the books on your reading list while doing almost anything, just like with podcasts. Start a 30-day trial and your first audiobook is free. Go to audible.com/psych or text psych, P-S-Y-C-H, to 500-500. That's audible.com/psych or text psych to 500-500 for a 30-day trial and a free first audiobook. You can do it with audiobooks. And now, without any further ado, let's go talk to Sarah Harry. So tell me about your relationship with food growing up.
Oh, I guess that's an interesting one, isn't it? I was recently at a professional development. It was about trauma, and there were 700 clinicians in the room, and the presenter put up their hand and said, "Who here is a wounded healer?" And I reckon 95% of people put up their hands. Oh. So it's really, really interesting that we're drawn a lot of the time to areas where we've struggled in our own lives. And certainly my struggles with food started extremely young because my family was extremely focused on thinness was the most highly prized possession in our family. It was kind of competed for, and there was money involved, and you know how many kilos per dollar, and it was a very difficult environment in that sense. And because there was such a focus on body, particularly, I would say my mom lives in a very small body, so she doesn't really understand it in the way that myself, my dad, and my brothers and sisters do. We're all big people, tall people, and big people. My dad is, I believe, you know, there's been a few, it's intergenerational. I believe that my belief is my grandmother had an eating disorder, and then my dad had brought some of that through with him. And so his policing of my body was very strong. So I would have been policed very young. I'm told I couldn't wear certain things, like from six, I have a memory where I wasn't allowed to wear a bikini and everyone else was. And then from about 8 or 10, I was put on kind of my first diet. And I think from then until I was 18, I would have done 100 diets, and I did all of them. And it was all parent supported. And, you know, you have to say, I have to be fair, and say when I was young, that was very much coming from my family and they very much supported and still would, if not for the extremely stern talking to they've had over the years, many times. they still they can't help themselves. They still embody some of that huge amount of diet culture within them that it just can't lose, which is fine, that I'm never going to be able to change that. I've tried to have conversations and we don't get anywhere. So, but, you know, my mum is much better than she was. But I also participated. I got drawn into diet culture extremely young because, you know, I went along to those diet programs. I had to sign special forms because I was way underage, which is appalling, really. And all I thought about, I mean, in my book, I wrote about it as a prison of numbers because all I thought about was numbers, whatever kind of number it was, whether it was a dress number or a gram number or anything number. I don't use numbers in my therapy or encourage people not to use them because I was absolutely imprisoned by it. I couldn't move for thinking about a number of some kind. And I remember really clearly at quite, you know, 16, going to bed and wishing to wake up thin. Like that would be, I call it the magic ticket, you know, that would be the magic ticket for everything. I would suddenly become lovable and have this life that I thought I didn't have, but I actually did. I had lots of friends and I had lots of great things in my life. I never had a lot of male attention. So I think a lot of that, because I identify as a cis white woman and I acknowledge my privilege in that sense, a cis straight white woman. So with all this privilege, I didn't have very much male attention. And I think that drove a lot of it for me. I had this very strong sense of unlovability. And I think that came from my grandmother, who took me aside one day when I was 8 or 10 and very quietly said, "You will never marry and you will, no one will ever love you."
Oh,
because you're so fat.
And, oh, that's horrifying.
Well, it is. And do you know what the worst thing is? As I've been able to see photos of that time, and I think that what horrifies me the most is that is not a fat child. There's nothing wrong with fat. I totally embrace it. I am fat myself, but that was not a fat child. So some of my experiences with food and eating, had I been, you know, had I had someone that had read Ellen Slater in my life and just left me alone with food and eating, I would have been fine. Do you know, there was absolutely no reason for me to develop the eating disorder I developed and to have the very long kind of traumatic in lots of ways relationship with food that I ended up having, which didn't end until, you know, my middle to late 20s when I ended up getting 2 lab bands and not at the same time.
Right. Oh my gosh. I really want to hear about that because that's a fascinating thing that not a lot of people talk about. And we haven't really delved into much on the podcast either.
Do you know what? I took Fiona Sutherland, who's a dietitian, aside because we worked together at Body Positive Australia when I was like in my late 20s and we just started working together. We hadn't actually really formed a company or started working. And I was crying and I said to her, "I have to tell you something." And she's like, "Oh my God, what could possibly be wrong?" And I'm like, "I have a lap band." And I thought she wasn't going to work with me. I had so much shame and there was so much shame and secrecy. I told my family, my parents and my immediate family supported it because of their support of diet culture in general. But I told everyone else and my friends that I was having a different surgery. So I lied about it for 15 years more, maybe. And then I decided to start talking about it a little bit more because I thought it would help people. And then I totally came out when I wrote my book and I'd been sort of coming out before then because it really helps people to understand that they're not a magic thing and where they can go wrong and that they don't cure eating disorders and, you know, all the mistakes that I made. But I felt so much shame. It was my dirty secret. I couldn't talk about it.
Oh, God, I can imagine. Yeah. I mean, I'm so curious that transition from how you got, you know, first of all, like what it was like in the younger years and your eating disorder and how that developed, and then what you thought about getting the lap band and sort of the magical thinking that maybe went along with that, and then how you made that transition into what you do now, because that's a really, really big shift, obviously.
Yeah, well, I used to work for Giorgio Armani. So I used to be a fashionista and jump on and off planes, and I worked in London for Max Mara, and I used to have a very, very, very different life. And then I actually saw one of those photos from around the time everyone was telling me your body's not right. And I looked at that photo and I thought, nah. And that's when I thought, well, you know, if I'm wrong about that, maybe I'm wrong about other things, and maybe this behavior that I'm kind of dismissing as normal, which was full-blown eating disorder, which I'd had for 10 years, and I was just kind of pretending it wasn't there. I mean, I kind of knew it was. It was driven completely by diet culture. It was driven by completely a desire to outrun my grandmother's prediction, to be loved, to be beautiful, because all people used to say to me every second day was, you've got such a beautiful face, which all the fat people in the world know means you'd be beautiful if you weren't so fat. Right. And translation.
Yeah, subtext. Like, so obvious.
I was trying to just outrun that, and I was mired in diet culture working for Giorgio Armani, because things like, you know, the men's department would, it was very, very extravagant. So things like, we had 20 people in the Australian office, but we had a cook and somebody that made lattes.
Oh my God.
So cook would cook lasagna for the menswear team and salad for the women's wear team.
Oh.
And it was just like,
oh my God.
Terrible. And if you had to have your eyebrows waxed, that was considered a legitimate business thing to go do. Like, you had to be completely groomed. And I had, on my first day when I came back from lunch, there was like 6 suits piled up on my desk in my size, quietly suggesting I never came to work in the outfit I was wearing that day, which I was really proud of, but apparently it was not good enough.
Oh my God.
It was so hilarious. So I came from that culture, and I had this realization that it was like literally it was a light bulb moment. And I took a day off work and I rang our local eating disorder service here, and because it was pre-everything, they had to post me the information. And I still didn't really believe as a person in a bigger body, because all the stuff I was doing really didn't make any difference. I mean, I'd go up, I'd go down. But I was still a bigger person. I'm still a tall person. I'm still a big person. So I didn't believe as a person that wasn't underweight that I was going to receive treatment. And I didn't believe I was worthy of treatment. And I also really sort of thought, oh, it's not really an eating disorder, which it was for a long, long time. And I hid it from everyone. I didn't tell anyone.
And that's such an important point, I think, that people need to understand, and that like anyone listening who's grappling with this themselves should hear, is that just because it doesn't look like, quote unquote, the stereotypical picture of an eating disorder that we see in diet culture, right? What's held up as a picture of an eating disorder in diet culture is not representative of the multifaceted ways that eating disorders look. And in fact, most eating disorders do not look like that stereotypical picture.
No, they don't. Not at all. Having worked in 15 years with people with eating disorders, they mostly look like normal everyday people on the street. And, you know, anyone who has any kind of feelings that maybe they're not valid about, that their body is somehow contributing to not being part of the eating disorder, making you not valid for treatment, or any thoughts like that, should seriously listen to the fact that the body really has nothing to do with the eating disorder.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
The body has nothing to do with your worth of treatment if you're unwell. Because my body stopped me for years seeking treatment. And when I finally did, I was really shocked that, and this is a long time ago, so we've come a long way since then, that they were just like, of course, you know, you're an extremely unwell person and you deserve treatment. And that is what you will get. Because I had chosen not to tell anyone, I also chose to do a research trial. It kind of gradually revealed itself that I was not a very good therapy candidate tables and didn't really want to talk about it. So I did a research trial. I'm like, I just want to fill out the forms. And it was a self-help trial, but I actually got allocated to a wonderful Australian doctor who wrote an incredible book called If Not Dieting, Then What?
Oh, wow. Yes. And that was, Fee told me, and a few other Australian guests I've had have told me that that was so instrumental in their shift as well.
Very much so. But I got to see him in my recovery. And so that made an incredible difference. And once I've decided to do something, I kind of get on with it. And also I can be impulsive. And I decided, no way is anybody else going to go through what I've been through. So at the age of 28, when I had recovered, I sold my house. I quit my high fashion glamorous job, and I moved back in with my parents, which was a big mistake, let me tell you. And I went back to university. So I already had a degree, I guess what you call an undergraduate degree, and I went back to do postgraduate work in counselling and psychotherapy.
That's awesome. I actually quit my job at 28 and went back to school too.
Oh,
so,
really?
Yep. I know how it is. I've been there. And I was in magazines, actually. I was working in food and nutrition journalism before that. So it was related to what I ultimately did. But I was working at a Condé Nast magazine, actually. And I was around a lot of these fashion-y people all the time. And that was part of what sort of made me feel like I don't really belong here. Like I feel bad about myself sometimes, you know, in this environment. So not at the magazine I was at, like Gourmet was full of lovely people, but just the environment of the building and of the cafeteria and of the other people we knew in the building. It was like, it was a very image conscious place to be. So
that's what it is, isn't it? How similar. That's amazing.
Yeah.
I think it's the emphasis on the external. Anywhere where your job emphasizes the external and you have a struggle with self-esteem and body image and eating disorders, you are going to struggle.
Totally. I mean, it exacerbated it so much for me because I was already struggling. I already had an eating disorder in my early 20s and ended up at that job in my mid to late 20s when I was still sort of coming out of it and still disordered with food. And it definitely helped me ultimately, I think, to be working at a food magazine because people really did have good relationships with food, or I could kind of see how to be freer around food, but it also was the nuances of it, like the atmosphere of image consciousness, I think really set me back as well. So yeah, that was an interesting time. My path was also very winding towards recovery, but it's like, I mean, what path isn't really? I feel like they all are, you know?
Yeah, that's true. Because while I was recovering, I walked into my first yoga class in a gym, which is a terrible gym. It's really sad. Oh, you don't have that word. Hang on, let me find another word. it was a really not glamorous gym. And they had this amazing yoga teacher on a Saturday morning, and I'm hypermobile, so I could do yoga really well. Turns out that's not so great later in life. That's another story.
So, hyperextension.
Yeah, I didn't know that I was hypermobile. I just knew this teacher kept complimenting me. And so I'm like, oh, my God, after hating sport, you know, being forced to do sport and always coming last and really not liking it and my family being very sporty, I found something that I really loved in my recovery. But it wasn't until 10, 15 years later that I got the courage to become a yoga teacher. Like, I just thought that all yoga teachers were small, bendy, could do extremely extravagantly difficult postures, aka the cover of Yoga Journal, and just didn't even think it was for me, which is a shame because it wouldn't have been great if I'd done my teacher training alongside my psychotherapy training. But just my path was to come to it later.
Right. Yeah, that's really interesting. So the stereotypical picture of a yogi was not something you saw yourself in.
No, good Lord, no. Like, but I didn't see that even when I was an eating disorder clinician, even when I was working. So I didn't do my yoga teacher training until I was 40. So that's a fair whack later. And I still, like, I mean, one of the people made me cry. Aww. When I was applying in the process, and another person just said basically no. And then I found a not-for-profit yoga studio, which was just wonderful and very welcoming. But I nearly gave up at the point. The first person I ever rang about it when I was 40 made me cry, because her questions are just so not sort of, I don't know, like it was just so off-putting, and she just made it seem like I wouldn't be able to keep up or do it or whatever. And she made a lot of assumptions about me. And that's another mistake, you know, assuming by looking at the body that someone, about someone's fitness or about someone's health. Or I was pretty aware at that stage that she was making those comments, but I was so disempowered by her power that I kind of almost let me put it off. I took a few months before I made another phone call to, you know, really lovely, lovely people. And then I didn't look back.
Wow.
It didn't happen.
And that was already as a therapist too, right? Like, so you had gone through your recovery.
Yeah, I went through my recovery. I became a volunteer at the Eating Disorder Foundation, and I worked in a hospital for a while. And then I met Fiona Sutherland, and we kind of went out on our own, and we have always done different things. So she has a mindful dietitian that she does, and I have fat yoga, which I do, and we have Body Positive Australia, which we do together. So we've worked together for 13 or 14 years, so we know each other extremely well.
That's awesome.
Which is really, really good, and we've had each other's back a number of times. Probably more than a number of times, and
all the time.
yeah. Together we have four boys. I don't know. The universe is telling us that. but wonderful. So yeah, I kind of went to university after I was recovered. The recovery journey for me was, in some ways, a straight. I was ready. I was sick for a long time, and then when I decided, I was ready, and I did it. You know how it's a part of it? A lot of the journey is to make the decision to start to do things differently. I'd already made the decision that I would do whatever they told me.
Yeah. What do you think helped you make that decision?
I think it was, yeah, it's probably weird to quote Christian Slater, but I heard a quote of his. And it was not about eating, it was about drugs, I think. And he said, I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. And I always remembered that because I was just sick of it. I just could not do it. I couldn't do it anymore. I was like at the end of what I could do. There was one kind of light bulb moment where I decided to reach out for help. And I was also ready to make the decision. And I always talk about this with people when I'm working with body image, because we live in this toxic culture, which makes recovery really difficult for people, because once you leave my office, you've got to come into a culture which tells you you're not good enough often. So I talk to people when I work with what I call body peace, that you have to make a decision. It has to be a decision to do and think and try things a bit more differently, because I would love to be the body peace fairy. And then the sort of fairy, and I would just love to give transformational moments to people and give them the power to make that decision and start and to just feel really strong and have body acceptance. I mean, I think if I could have a magic wand, I would give people body acceptance, you know, peace and ease in their body. You know, that would be my thing.
Yeah, that would be amazing.
Maybe we could kind of like, yeah, arrange that somehow.
Body image, fairy godmothers. Yeah, I love that.
That's right. I bestow on you, buddy. I would completely put myself out of business, but I would be very happy about that. I'd be absolutely fine with me, because people come to me of all shapes and sizes, really, literally all shapes and sizes. And this is what I say to people when we work with body image, is the bodies look different, but the pain is the same. Everybody is allowed to feel bad about their body, even if all your friends say, oh, you shouldn't feel bad, you look great, or whatever. Which a lot of people that happens to, and that really disempowers them in smaller bodies. Obviously, I'm very interested in being disempowered in a bigger body and the stigma and discrimination that we face there. But it's also very disempowering if you're in a smaller body and someone dismisses your experience because you meet society's ideal form. Your pain is still there. Your pain of the body image is still there.
Yeah, that's an important point to make, I think, because it's so in diet culture, I think it's so easy for people to be dismissed or for their issues to be overlooked because their bodies seem to fit the cultural norm when, or the cultural ideal when they're really struggling. And that's one way in which fat phobia hurts everybody, disempowering people in smaller bodies too, because of fat phobia.
Exactly. Yeah. And I came out as a fat activist a few years ago. I made a conscious decision to move from being a body positive activist to being a fat activist because I felt that that was an important thing to do, to make the distinction between the two things. So I'm very interested in the stigma and discrimination in fat bodies, but I believe that it also affects bodies of all sizes, and really it's not okay either.
Yeah, I was just, Virgie Tovar, who's been on the podcast a couple of times, just wrote a piece called, I forget what it's called, something like The Three Levels of Fat Phobia or something, which she distinguishes between like the internalized fat phobia or the intrapersonal level within the person that each of us feels within diet culture. Basically, everybody feels this no matter what size they're in, the internalized fat phobia and the body shame that people of all sizes can have. And then there's the interpersonal level and the societal level. And those are levels which more distinctly affect people in larger bodies. But it's like people of all sizes sort of share this intrapersonal level. And then actually there's the interpersonal level, which is like someone in your life bullying or shaming you for your size.
Absolutely.
Which primarily affects people in larger bodies, but also like that experience you mentioned about being a little kid and having your grandmother say that to you when you weren't objectively in a larger body then. Like, is also a part of fat phobia that I think affects a lot of people across different sizes too. This shaming that happens when someone deems you to be just slightly outside of the cultural ideal, whatever that means.
Yeah, and that was her eating disorder talking. I believe that she it was never named in it, but I believe that she had anorexia, and that was her eating disorder and her experience with food talking to me. But at that age, and also, I mean, that took a lot of dismantling, that unlovability. Is that a word?
Yeah, it is now.
I worked on feeling unlovable because I did come to love and embrace therapy after a little while.
Right. I would imagine if you went on to be a therapist, like there had to be some transition there.
Yeah, they pretty much forced you to do that in our course. But I still have a therapist. If something comes up in my life that's difficult, I believe in it so much. There was an article released yesterday that counseling per se wasn't proven to be effective, and it was a very poorly designed research project. But I believe that therapy is an integral part of keeping up, because I believe in HAES. So health at every size for me also includes my mental health. And if I need to have a mental health tune up and I need to see something about something in particular, then I will. And I am absolutely unapologetic about my own mental health struggles in public, because I believe the more we can do to break down stigma, the better. And it helps people. You know, I once had kind of a little bit of depression around my family, and they just didn't know how to cope. They're like, what? They ended up getting mad with me for not being happy.
Oh,
and it was really hard because people don't know. And a lot of what, after we talked about it a little bit, they were like, but we just didn't know what to do. And that's really true. And unless we keep talking about mental health, eating disorders included, but unless we talk about, I mean, I don't know about you, but my experience is that a lot of my clients with eating disorders will also struggle with other aspects of mental health, be it anxiety or some aspect.
Totally.
These are intelligent, smart people. And they were like, what do we do? She's so sad. So I'm like, you know, all you need to do, we have a program here called Are You Okay? And you just need to ask me, am I okay? And then give me space to say, you know, what I might need or not need, and just love me through it. You know, it's the same with how to look after someone with an eating disorder. Just love me through it.
Right. Yeah. And not feel like you have to fix or be responsible for the person's emotions.
You don't need to do anything. You just need to be there, give them a hug, say you love them. But, you know, some people do struggle with those things.
Right. Yeah, it is. I mean, I've definitely always been a caretaking type of person, definitely had some codependency in my earlier years, and still sometimes struggle with having to let go of the desire to wave that magic wand and help somebody like when they're really struggling. And actually, I've kind of shifted my practice in a way that helps me draw that line, because now I'm not seeing full-blown eating disorders anymore. I'm working with intuitive eating and doing intuitive eating coaching for people who are like at the end of their recovery, you know, behavior free or never had a full-blown eating disorder but have been chronic dieters and stuff. And I've found that that has helped me step away from the overly involved role that I would sometimes feel myself pulled into with eating disorders, because I think it is really, you know, it feels really serious and it feels really upsetting sometimes to sit with people's eating disorder and to know what they're going through with that. And my heart goes out to people who are the caretakers of or the loved ones of people with eating disorders, because it is so hard.
It's a hard job. And I'm a caretaker of two young boys that have issues. And you know, you become their case manager, you become their advocate, you become their driver, you become their everything. So like, I kind of understand the care role really well, and it's a difficult role. And I did a similar thing to you for self-care when I looked at my practice and I decided I wasn't going to treat one particular eating disorder that other people struggle to treat, but I found that it drained me from the inside, and I just really struggled with it. So I decided I would say no to those people and see only this other group of people. And on that from a self-care and a clinician's point of view, because we always have to be, this is a big burnout area for people. A lot of people here in Australia that used to work in this field, sometimes some of them go away, you know, we don't see them again.
Yeah, same in the US.
Shame, because they're so skilled and I really want to keep doing this work forever. Well, I'm 45, so maybe not forever.
For decades to come, at least.
Yeah, for a little bit more, maybe with a little other stuff, because things evolve and change. And, you know, now I have an online course and I didn't think I'd ever do that, and run retreats and I didn't think I'd do that. So things evolve and change. Sure. But one of the things that I did for self-care was to identify that one type of eating disorder hurt me exactly the same as you. So we have lots of similarities.
Totally. And I think we also have similarities in like doing lots of different things too, and being sort of open to evolution in our careers. But I think it's really important to give yourself that space and that self-care, because I've found that, like, same to you, I really want to keep doing this work in whatever way I'm called to do, or whatever way is granted to me by the universe or whatever, like whatever way sort of works for me and for other people. And I have found that that's primarily the podcast, you know, that that's a way that I reach so many people, and it feels great to me to do it. And it feels like people are getting a lot out of it. And I get lots of letters all the time that people are saying they're loving it. So I'm like, okay, this is a role that I can play using my skills as a journalist, using my skills as a clinician, and sort of bringing this all together in a way that works for me. And the practice, especially with the full-blown eating disorders, just wasn't giving me that same vibe of like, this is what I'm called to do. This is what I'm here for. And so shifting it in this way to work with, you know, just do the one-on-one work with a small group of people that's very specific sort of point in people's journey that really resonates with me. Like, I've found so much fulfillment in that. And I had some guilt around it at first, because I loved my clients. I loved all the people that I was working with full-blown eating disorders. Like, it wasn't about not loving the people, but it was just, how was the work landing with me, and how was it affecting my own self-care and my own ability to show up in the rest of my work and in my life, you know, my personal life.
The rest of, yeah, exactly. Because we actually, I mean, I know it's crazy, but therapists actually do have personal lives.
And right.
We need to make sure that we, sometimes people don't realize that when they call me at whatever time in the morning, but I do have fun and I would like to preserve it into some degree. So it's important. I think it's really important work. I always try and see if I can keep myself reflecting. And of course, that's the power of supervision. You know, we all have to have someone to talk to about our jobs. And that's the power of the supervision role, I think.
Right. Yeah, I feel like that's something that therapists get sort of along the way by default. It's like you're always expected to consult with someone, do supervision, have mentorship, like whatever it's called, whatever part of the field you're in or whatever. It's like that's sort of a standard practice. But coming from a dietetics background, like that was not standard practice for us starting out. And I had to, you know, thankfully I discovered that through my work in the eating disorders field. And it's been so helpful in building my business, but also my sort of resilience and ability to do this work effectively, learning from people who've been there before me, and also having somewhere to go and to like offload some of the feelings that come up too, and be like,
yeah,
right, like have support for that. But not enough dietitians have that.
I know, it's the same thing. Like it's, they have to do their first year. I think they need a mentor, and then after that, there's no kind of impetus to pay for supervision or requirement. Whereas as a therapist, I at the minimum have to do 10 hours plus my personal development of supervision. And that's expensive. It's expensive thing to do, but it's an amazing investment. And I hope the future of dietetics really, any, you know, includes it in a lot more formalized way across all the countries.
I know, me too. I think it would be revolutionary if that happened. Because I think so many dietitians do struggle. There's research on that now too, that dietitians are more likely to have orthorexia, more likely to have eating disorders in general, more likely to struggle with this stuff, which makes complete sense. Because like you said, you know, there's this attraction to the thing that we want to master, or the thing that we went through, you know, the wounded healer thing is very real in this field as well. And I went through it too. Like my own eating disorder is the reason that I'm here now, the reason that I'm doing this work, and the reason that I became a dietitian. And like, I'm ultimately grateful for it, for that, even though I wouldn't wish it on myself to go through again, you know, but it's like, it got me somewhere, you know, or at least the ability. I mean, really it wasn't the eating disorder itself. It was the ability to recover from the eating disorder and then reflect on it and make meaning out of it. That's why I'm here.
I know. And I find that a lot of people who recover are interested in helping people. And I think it's a wonderful thing. When I first went for my first internship, you know, practical kind of posting, I applied at the Royal Children's Hospital in the Centre for Adolescent Health, their eating disorder unit. And the person that interviewed me said, "Have you ever had any mental health issues?" And I said, "Yes, here they all are." And she said, "Oh, no, 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 you cannot work here."
Oh, my God.
And so I'm a pretty good, you don't want to be my boyfriend because I'm a super awesome arguer. So I argued with that woman for however long it took to completely reverse that decision. Like I said to her, no, this is the reasons why that I am, you know, completely recovered. And these are the reasons why you need to change this policy and let me come and work here, because I have insight that you will never get from anyone else. And I have a lived experience, which is not going to harm anyone, but is going to enhance the way that I work with people. And I just argued my way in, basically.
Wow, that's awesome.
But it was really interesting that they had this very formal idea that if you had had any kind of mental illness, you were disqualified from working there.
And then that would just disqualify like most everyone. Of the applicants, right? Like 99.9% of anyone. Like, that's ridiculous.
Yeah, that's right. I know. So I've been being honest about it for a long time. And I think sometimes that hasn't helped me. And that could have gone the other way. She could have completely said to me, "No, go." And that would have changed the course of what I did. But she didn't. She listened. And that's always the kind of the hallmark of the good therapist, right? You listen. So she listened and she took what I had to say on board, and they changed it and they let me come on board, because I think they had this feeling that I would be too emotionally kind of fragile to deal with clients or patients and hospital. And that wasn't true, because I was recovered. I was good.
Right. I think that's an important distinction of like going into it when you have reached a point of recovery where you're not in it anymore and you're not too fragile to handle that stuff, right? You're not going to be triggered by people's eating disorders around you, which I think is a tricky line to sort of define, because when people first go into the field, you know, I know a lot of people who have reached out to me from the podcast and said, "I'm studying to be a therapist or a dietitian, or I am a therapist or dietitian, and I'm struggling with this stuff on my own. How do I handle this?" And so I think it is really challenging to figure out what's the right time to do this work that's not going to set you back. And again, like prioritizing your own self-care and your own personal life and your own recovery. Because if you can't be here, if you can't get through the eating disorder to the other side, you're not going to be able to do this work either. You're not going to be able to continue and have the longevity in the field to help people. So you really need to get your own stuff in order first and prioritize yourself so that you can show up in a way that benefits people too.
Well, yeah, and we have a wonderful, because we run group work and I love working with groups, and we have a wonderful now co-facilitator called Anna Henry, and she's a wonderful person, and she experienced an eating disorder, and she asked me, okay, how long do I have to wait until I can come and work with you? And lots of people ask me that question, but I think I said to her, maybe 4 years. And I just kind of like, I don't know. That's a long time. I don't know if I'd say that length of time now. But anyway, 4 years later, my phone rang. And she said, okay, I'm ready now. And I'm like, you absolutely, come on in, girl. Like, you are working for us for sure. 4 years later, you waited for, absolutely. And she's been with us for like 6 years now.
Oh, that's awesome.
And she's amazing. And she was, so maybe 4 years is the magic number. I don't know. I think it's different for everyone. And I probably did discuss it with her at the time. You know, how would you feel at this time? You know, it's more about how you feel and how you are and what triggers you and what doesn't. And because actually, I don't think you can just pull a number out and say it's X years until you're ready, because that doesn't seem responsible. It seems like it might be individual dependent. But anyway, for her, that was the right amount of time. And she has been working with us ever since and is a wonderful, wonderful clinician, and shares her story, you know, shares her, I'm not saying anything out of turn, she shares her story that she's a recovered person. So
yeah. Yeah, because I think it can be so powerful to share that. And once you're on the other side of it, to show like, hey, it's possible to get to the other side. It's possible to be fully recovered and not have these issues coming up all the time, and to be really free from diet culture, even though we live in diet culture, to be able to navigate it and be resilient against it is super powerful, because a lot of our clients are just really in it right now and don't have that hope or that idea of what even it looks like to be on the other side.
Exactly. Like I had, we call it weight week, which is, a, you know, usually a fun week in our 14-week program this weekend. And they were kind of asking me about my own body piece, I guess, my own body acceptance. And I'm like, what I had to learn, then the decisions I had to make were the most important thing about me is not what I look like. I had to absolutely embody that and know that and still understand that all body image specialists or clinicians or whatever, it doesn't mean I'm immune to the culture. It doesn't mean that I haven't had days where I think, oh, maybe I should go and do something or whatever. And I think that's an important point. People think that you are perfect, and I think lots of people like Virgie and lots of people will come out and say, you know, it's not perfect. It's not being perfect all the time is not the deal of body acceptance, you know, because we live in such a toxic culture. So I always say that I'm not perfect, but I embrace a strong body acceptance. And I have all these sayings like, you know, if you don't want to look at me, just look away, you know, like me and my bathers and my legs offend you, or my very brightly colored yoga pants, my tight top, and you don't like it, look away.
Right. It's not assaulting anybody with your presence. Like they can.
Yeah, I'm sorry if you don't like my legs, but it's not really my problem.
Right.
You know?
No.
So, you know, I just believe that the most important thing about all of us is not our external appearance. And coming to understand that about yourself is a big shift for people in body image work, I think.
So huge.
Lots of shifts, but that is one thing. I accept myself. I am important enough and worthy enough and strong enough to be here in this world that values bodies and still be okay with my body that doesn't look like everyone else.
Mm-hmm. I love that. And I think also the idea of having it not be the most important thing about you, I would add to that too, like your health is also not the most important thing about you. Because I've seen a lot of people with orthorexia or having a really strong orthorexic component to their eating disorder, where it's like hard to give up that idea of what if my health isn't perfect or my eating isn't perfect or I'm not eating enough vegetables or whatever, like what's going to happen to me, you know, and the identity piece that's sort of wrapped up in that. And it's like, also, that's not the most important thing about you. Like our health is malleable. That's going to change across time. It's not about the absence of disease, because most of us have some sort of chronic disease that we live with, some sort of condition that we're managing. So it's not about being perfect or having like a completely clean bill of health, whatever that means. It's about taking care of yourself and doing the best you can with what you've got at whatever stage of life you're at. And that's going to look very different for different people at different times of life or different abilities and disabilities and everything. So like, we can't also put moral value on health and make that the arbiter of our goodness or our worthiness.
No, exactly. And there are people that have come to my yoga classes that are pursuing movement in some way and health as part of that. And I can have people in my class who need to sit in a chair, some people that can't kneel on their knees, some people with prosthetics, some people, like, there is levels of, and some people with illnesses that I can't see, chronic pain and fibromyalgia and all sorts of different things that they'll tell me about, but I can't see them. They walk in and they may look like that there's nothing going on for them. And that's also, you know, a problem for people with chronic illness and pain, because I can't see it. So I look around my class sometimes and there is a lot there of people pursuing health and movement and in the Hayes paradigm that it's not perfect. As you say, you described it exactly perfectly. It's your version of it.
Right.
In your body with your conditions.
Totally. And I think that sort of quote unquote picture of health that's being sold to us, especially at this point in history, that's so rarefied, like, oh, you have to have your green juice and your perfect workout clothes and be going to yoga and look a certain way on Instagram and be young and able-bodied and cisgendered and white and all of this stuff, right? It's like that supposed picture of health is just another manifestation of diet culture. Like that's a new guise of diet culture for the 21st century. That's not actually health.
It's extremely privileged too. Like
yes.
For you to be able to afford to go and live like that and buy things like that and engage like that is a very small percentage of the world that is privileged enough to have the resources to do that.
Totally. And even some of these like lifestyle bloggers or, you know, Instagram lifestyle people can't actually afford their lifestyle. Like they're not, you know, you're seeing this picture of what it looks like or what it supposedly is. And the reality is very different. Like the behind the scenes is very different. These people are in credit card debt, trying to live a certain way to depict that on their social media, you know? So I think, yeah, sort of taking a step back from it or taking a, I'm trying to not even have to say like, step metaphors, because I feel like that's ableist. But like,
oh, yes.
Taking a bit, you know, getting back from it a bit and just giving some space to say, this is not what health looks like for everyone. This is this new manifestation of diet culture and this thing that's being used to sell us stuff in this day and age. But, you know, whenever there's something being used to sell us stuff, 99% of the time, I think of it as like the image or the aspirational quote unquote thing that's being used to sell stuff is not real. Like that's the point of it. It's not real so that people will think they have to get it and they don't have it and therefore they'll fork over money to buy it.
Yeah, you're being sold the gold. It's again, it comes back to me to be the golden ticket, and the golden ticket doesn't exist. You're being sold something that actually doesn't exist in this amazing marketing model, which makes it then your fault that when it doesn't work, which,
right.
I mean, they're geniuses, these people.
Seriously. I know. There's no other industry that has mastered it quite like that, blaming people when the product doesn't work.
I know, because I lecture at university sometimes, and I always say to them, like when I'm trying to explain Hayes to them and explain the failure rate of diets, I'm like, okay, so imagine you bought an iPad And there's a little tag attached to your iPad that said, there is a 98% chance that this won't work. Would you buy it?
Like, no.
I have to put it in their language. They're like, would you buy this? And they're like, no. And I'm like, do you understand?
It's the same thing.
But they're so resistant. So I teach young dietitians like Fiona. And I had one person walk out this year, which is a personal best. I've never actually.
You're doing something right if it's, you know.
Yeah. 8 years of teaching this class, someone actually got up and walked out. And then the other thing is drawing on what we were talking about before is then I get later a number of emails from participants of those lectures to say, you know what, I'm struggling hard, or I have a really bad eating disorder, or they show up in my private practice. So I don't mind the person that walks out. That's their journey.
Right.
Because I know I can reach the people. Fiona Sutherland has done the most incredible job of covering our entire state. And I think we're well on our way to having Hayes in nearly all the dietetics programs.
That's amazing.
What we need now is for it to go into medicine.
Oh, yes.
Quite another.
Another battle. I mean, that's better than we're doing here, though, because there's like one program that is Hayes for dietitians at this point. So I think we need to do a lot more. There's definitely folks out there, like my colleagues lecturing, you know, doing one lecture here or there or whatever. But I think to have a whole program or a whole course devoted to Hayes is still very rare.
Oh, yeah, we don't get, no, don't misunderstand me. We don't get entire courses.
Okay.
we just get someone awesome like Fiona go in for however many hours. And the really funny thing is they give me counseling skills. So we get 8 hours. So these health professionals who are going to sit in front of people counseling them for their entire career get 8 hours of skills. And if anyone, you know, that employs me is listening to this, I'm very grateful for those 8 hours, so don't take them away from me.
Right.
But really, that should be an entire course, because that's what you do. You talk to people, you know. It's a vital skill, but I am grateful for my 8 hours.
Yeah, I mean, it's great to have that, you know, and just hopefully you'll get more because people need it. I want to go back to talking a little more about the surgery, the lap band surgery, the weight loss surgery, because I'm curious about your experience with that, both mentally and physically, the reactions that your body had to that, and then also how it affected your body acceptance journey and recovery journey yourself.
I think it put my body acceptance journey back many years. I was an extremely early adopter because in my diet culture journey, I was one of those people who I had a computer very early. My dad was really interested in that stuff. Like, I think he told me the cost of it one day and I was like, no way. You spent $10,000 on a computer. So I was able to kind of search for stuff, and I would buy everything and anything I could get my little mitts on. And I remember the day that the Oprah cookbook arrived and being so excited that was going to solve all my problems.
Oh, my God, yes.
So I knew about the lap band. And in Australia, actually, Australia was a very early adopter, much earlier than the US, of the lap band. And so I knew about it. It was reversible. It didn't cut his stomach. And I wasn't happy with my body. I'd recovered from my eating disorder, but, and this is what I find again and again, this is why I run Body Peace, is the online program, because what I find is sometimes when people recover, and I think this is some of the work you do too, like when they've recovered, they're still not either intuitive eating well, or their body image is not where they would like it to be. But they may be weight restored, or they might be not binging anymore, you know, those sorts of things. So I find a lot of people like, which is why I put the Body Peace thing together, to try and get that last bit, because a lot of people will be discharged from treatment at that time. And I think that's a big in kind of public system stuff. And I think that's a really big mistake. And that's what happened to me. A psychologist said to me, you don't have an eating disorder anymore, so away you go. And I said to her, but I hate my body. And she's like, but you don't have an eating disorder, so off you go.
Oh.
So I was lost in that sense. And because I had that experience, I know that my clients have that experience, I was like stuck. I hate my body. I have no body acceptance. This is not what, you know, this is way before I called myself recovered. So what am I going to do? They told me in my eating disorder recovery, I could never diet again. So it becomes a $64 million question. What do I do? So I am strongly not recommending people do this. By the time you've heard this story, you won't want to anyway. So I thought a good idea would be to have lap band surgery. And of course, my parents being, well, both lovely people and invested in fitness, supported that decision and helped me a little bit financially as well, which was what I thought was great at the time. And I was kind of sold it. You go to the surgeon, you step on the scales, and I was just, I was not quite there, like just about. And he's like, yeah, it's fine. And in terms of, you know, what would be considered okay to perform weight loss surgery at someone, I was never screened for an eating disorder. No one ever asked me, although they had a psychologist, I saw a psychologist, I saw a dietitian. You know, they had this proper program set up, but it was so geared towards just kind of funneling me towards this very lucrative surgery. And I so remember paying the bill. And as I was paying the bill to the woman who happened to be the husband of the surgeon, who's now retired, she looked to me and she said, because it was Christmas time, she said, by next Christmas, you'll be X kilos, which was lower than I'd ever been in my whole life, like lower than I'd ever been at like 15 or 25, 10 years old or something. And you'll be in this incredible bikini. The bikini comes up again.
That's interesting.
And I just, you know, handed over the cash. Like, I just was like, I absolutely believed that this was going to be the thing. There was no indication given to me of the risk factors, of the dangers, of anything that could possibly go wrong. It was supposed to make me not hungry. It was supposed to be literally magic. Plus, like, you know, adjustable. It was like magic. So bought that one, hook, line and sinker, and pretty much from day one I was in chronic pain and vomiting, which, you know, having recovered from an eating disorder, I kind of felt like I'd kind of gone backwards. There was one occasion where they filled it up, you know, that you have to fill it, they fill it with saline, and they filled it up too tight so I couldn't even swallow my own saliva, so I had to be admitted to hospital because you'll die within hours that happens.
Oh my God.
You have hours. You have a very short amount of time to leave if you can't swallow.
Jeez, that's terrifying. I never even considered that. Oh.
No, because nothing could go through because they did it too tight. And a couple of times they did it too tight and I could only swallow like tiny, tiny bits of water, which of course will end you in hospital again. So extremely dangerous, like very, very dangerous. But also I lived this life of pain. Like I was in constant pain. And I just thought that was, I deserved it or something, that was the way it was supposed to be. And I wasn't not hungry. This idea of not being hungry, it was just ridiculous. I could feel the hunger underneath the lap band. So all in all, it was like a horrifying experience. And then as a large proportion, like 30% or 40% of lap bands do, mine in the first year slipped. So it went out of whack, like moved. So that had much more horrible symptoms. You know, I woke up choking in the middle of the night and all sorts of fun things.
Oh my God.
I talk about this like stuff like it's terrible. It's shocking. I mean, it's really bad.
Yeah. And this is the one that is touted as being safer too. That's like, right? Oh, it's yeah. It's minor surgery. It's fine.
It was minor surgery. It was keyhole. It was easy, you know.
God.
And then so they said, okay, so you need another band. And at that point, I was not recovered. So I did not say what I should have said, which is take it out and move away.
Yeah.
They made it sound like they had maybe there was a slight positioning error. And they never said they did anything wrong, but they kind of made it sound a bit like maybe it was my fault or maybe I hadn't done something right or maybe I wasn't chewing my food. Oh, I don't know, whatever. It was all kind of clouded as my fault, but if I redid the surgery, all the problems would then be fixed. Guess how this story ends.
Yeah.
I had the surgery, the second surgery, and it was exactly the same. So I then endured another however many years of pain and suffering, and didn't really, I mean, really, truly, I remember the nurse saying to me as I was going into surgery, why are you doing this? You do not need to do this. That was kind of my last memory before they put me out.
Wow.
Because I really should not have been allowed to do it. And anyway.
Voice of reason, but a little too late.
Yeah. As I descended into anesthesia. So it took a while for me to understand that I was in chronic pain and that I didn't deserve it. And that was my body acceptance journey, was to understand that I needed to have. So what in the end I did was have every single bit of fluid taken out of that band as a test to see if that would resolve the problem and it would feel like I didn't have one, rather than I've had a lot of abdominal surgeries. I've had a lot of illness. There's a lot of scar tissue. I didn't want to have another abdominal surgery. So that's what they did, and there's no problems. So I actually still have it. I will in the next couple of years. I just recently consulted with a professor about it. She said, get it out soon. It's not urgent, but get it out soon. You don't want to be a 90-year-old woman having to have a lot of
pressure. Oh, God, no. much worse time.
It's more timing and stuff. I don't feel it. I can't. It doesn't hurt me. I can't. Nothing. There's nothing there. So that, I think, once I had the ability to eat and learn how to eat intuitively and completely mend my relationship with food and my body and accept the fact that this was my body. I mean, I gave it a red hot 2-surgery go to change my body. So the universe told me that this was it, baby. So learn how to look after it, love it, nurture it, and accept it because it was yours, you know. And that sounds like it was easy, but of course everyone struggling with body acceptance knows it wasn't. It's not an easy journey. In fact, I think it's hard. I think it's in some ways harder, you know, because of the culture. Every time you step outside, the culture said, no, you're wrong.
Yep, totally.
So that happened to me, and gradually over time I developed my own sense of body acceptance, which is quite fierce now, which led to me, obviously, I mean, that was many years ago, I guess, a few years ago, led to me being able to want to do things like become a yoga teacher so I could, you know, show people. Because in Australia at that time, when I became a yoga teacher, there was really only Anna Gastelli, I think, doing it. And she was kind of my hero. And then I wasn't really on Instagram. I didn't really see the people. So I'm bringing Diane Bodies coming out to Australia next year, which is amazing.
Yeah. Nice.
For 2 retreats, which is going to be incredible. So I have all these heroes that I want to bring to Australia and run yoga retreats. So I really was the only person in Australia doing it. And it took a lot of courage because, you know, the first time I went on TV, I got like 8 mail from God everywhere. People ringing me and it's horrible stuff. But there was a point 5 years ago or so where I decided, would I be a public person about this stuff or would I be a private person about this stuff? And I decided I would be a public person for the benefit of other people, because really, actually, if you even have to monetize it, I make no money from being public about it, really. But I decided I would be public about it. So that's where Fat Yoga came from, and that's where the book came from and talking out about it came from, and more talking on television and more doing stuff like that and things like you and talking to you and, you know, like that kind of thing. So I think I'm going to have a little break from the public side maybe for a little bit and then go back to it. But that's kind of the story of it. It's nothing to ever recommend to anyone ever for different reasons. Because I've experienced it.
Right. Yeah, it's not just academic for you. It's not just like, well, looking at the research, here's what happens.
Not what the research says, what happened to me, and, you know, and the pain that they don't tell you about, and the vomiting which they don't tell you about, and the, you know, like they don't tell you a lot of things. And that's my message with this stuff, is what they don't tell you feels a god, feels an ocean. Do you know?
Yeah. I mean, it's in their best interest not to tell you, right? It's not in your best interest, because you end up with these side effects and terrible, you know, experiences that they didn't warn you about, but you paid them money and you had the surgery, and so they benefited.
Oh my God, so much money. So much. So much
it's
money.
Unbelievable how much money they make.
And so my experience and the lived experience is quite different from the research experience, which is just don't do this. And my experience is don't do it because it's awful and painful, and your experience of food changes forever when you can only have a couple of mouthfuls of it. And I just didn't want, I love food. I just intuitively eat now, and I can't imagine that I risked that. Had I had a different surgeon who'd done a different operation, I would have lost my stomach, you know, and it would have been a very different experience. And luckily, I did it.
Yeah. And I know many people who did, and their intuitive eating journey is so much harder for it. So my heart goes out to everyone who's struggling with that. But thank you for sharing that story and that experience, because I think it is really powerful for people to hear that if they're going through this, they're not alone. They're not broken. That's not something they did wrong. It's actually the surgery.
It's part of diet culture. It's part of diet culture, I think.
Yeah.
Selling. It's as much selling as Revlon. Do you know, like, it's as much for a diet company, or, you know, like, it's as much selling you something. They were selling me the dream of the same thing, the golden ticket. Do you know, they were still just selling me the dream of weight loss. You're a victim of diet culture, whether it's a diet company or somebody who's selling you an 8-week program that's going to transform you into some sex goddess.
Or bariatric surgery.
Yeah.
I've been speaking a lot about how diet culture shape shifts. And I've been using this metaphor lately of the life thief, where it's like the sneaky thief that steals your life, right? Your time, your money, your health, your happiness, your social life, all of this stuff.
True.
And it's sneaky about it because people are getting wise. You know, people are onto it now in this day and age, right? Like Weight Watchers and Jenny Craig have been in decline, and the sort of traditional diet model of years past and generations past is like younger folks are wise to that now, right? So diet culture has to shapeshift. It has to go into different forms. It has to go into like bariatric surgery, which is supposedly for your health, quote unquote, or medical weight loss or whatever, which is couched in this health argument, or orthorexia and like green juice and Instagram wellness culture, or wellness culture in general, which is also a new manifestation of diet culture. Like all of it is this sneaky shape-shifting manifestation of the life thief, which wants to steal your life, and it makes money from that. Like it benefits from that. And if people are getting wise and putting their wallet in their front pocket instead of their back pocket, it can't just pickpocket you the way that it used to easily. Like now it has to find new ways of getting into your wallet.
Yeah. And one of the ways, because it's not a diet anymore. Did you realize it's a lifestyle change?
Oh yeah. Lifestyle change.
You don't use it. Not a diet.
We don't diet.
Oh, no. Diet dieting is so last year.
Right. Diets don't work. Do this plan instead.
Oh, don't. No, diets never work as they drink their green juice. Like it's like, it's harder. It's got actually, your life thief has got clever and clever and cleverer.
Totally. Yeah, it's really sneaky. So people need to just be aware, I think, of all the many guises that it goes under and just fight back against that, which is hard because a lot of people are into it.
Yeah, and it takes energy, you know? And so sometimes we have to decide where we're going to place that energy and how we're going to do it. And, you know, I'm a big believer in that, to understand how much energy I have and where I'm going to put it. And I don't think a lot of people, I had a whole group of people on Saturday, we were also talking about self-care, and they were like, every time I sit down to watch TV or Netflix or something, I feel guilty. I'm like, oh my God, we need to have a serious chat about this. Like,
right. You know?
We are not feeling guilty when we sit down on the couch. Like this is not what is underneath all this. This idea that you've got to be keeping on being productive and doing something and being something and keep on, and it's quite competitive. And these are young women, you know, and they want to do things and achieve things. And if you sit down, you're failing. And I'm like, oh my God, no.
I remember feeling like that in my 20s also, and having to. That was another part of my recovery journey, was just learning to do nothing, learning to do self-care, because, yeah, it's so helpful and so wonderful to just sit on the couch all day sometimes, you know? Like I did that just 2 days ago. We went to a wedding on Saturday and we're kind of running around and doing lots of stuff and out late the night before. And then Sunday, I just stayed indoors the whole day and watched TV, and it was like delightful. Like it was all I wanted to do. It was so cuddly, and just like had my blanket and my tea and just watching TV, and I felt amazing.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
See, I like the nap. You know, I always tell my groups, really like the nap, and the nap really works for me. And they're like, yes. But what about the yoga and the meditation? I'm like, yeah, I do all those things too. That is self-care, but there's lots of levels of self-care too, you know, and there is deep relaxation, whatever. That's why I never tell people what to do. I get them to figure out for themselves. But you also need to have self-care that isn't like, I must go to my yoga class, I must do my meditation, that is just pure hedonistic, cozy in a blanket, something that makes you, nourishes your soul, you know, and replenishes you, because otherwise you can't go on.
Yeah. And self-care shouldn't be homework too. I think there's definitely a place for going to a class or making time for that or whatever, but not if what your body and soul are really asking for is just like, let me just stay in one place and rest. That's what you need.
Yeah. But you've got to have body trust to be able to listen to your body, to listen and understand wants, you know, and that's the work that we all do to try and get people to come home to their bodies, which is one of the expressions that I absolutely love.
I love that too. Yeah, because your body is your home.
Yeah, one and only.
These are our homes for the time that we're on this planet, so we have to be in them.
Yeah, absolutely, and we take care of them in the best way that we can, but not in a perfect way. You've got to get rid of this idea of being perfect about it. Somebody said to me the other day, what we're going for here is good enough.
Yes, I love that.
You know, like, that's all.
Yeah. That's it. It just has to be good enough. Oh, I love it. Okay, good enough. Let me move on. That's, you know, or let me rest. Just that's good enough too, right?
Exactly.
Oh my God, I could talk to you all day about this stuff. This is so wonderful, and the time has flown by so fast. But we are going a little long, so I wanted to ask where people can find you and learn more about your work and all the different things you do, because you have so many great offerings to the world.
Yeah, I do. Well, you can find me if you're interested in yoga and retreats in your, well, international or Australian, at fatyoga.com.au. You can also find me at bodypositiveaustralia.com.au. You can find me on Instagram, because I want my Instagram followers. Bodypositiveyoga is my Instagram. And yeah, I do lots of things. And you can see on both those websites that I run at what's called Body Peace, which is a online program, which I'll run again in January, which is a really lovely program for combining yoga and psychology to work with body image, which I believe is the first of its kind. And I've been running that for a little bit, and it's beautiful, and you can do that anywhere in the world. So, yeah.
That's wonderful. We'll link to all that in the show notes. And I love the name Body Peace too. That's just such a wonderful, evocative term.
It's lovely. I love it.
Oh, I love it. Well, thank you so much, Sarah. It's a pleasure talking with you.
Oh, it's lovely to talk to you. Your voice is so familiar. It feels like coming home because I love you.
Thank you. That's awesome.
So thank you for having me.
Thank you. So that's our show. Thanks again so much to Sarah Harry for joining us on this episode. And thanks to you for listening. I have some really exciting news to share with you, which is that we have some beautiful new t-shirts and mugs for the new year, which is exactly the time we need more tangible messages to help us counteract diet culture. They have one of our fan favorite sayings from the podcast, which is self-care, not self-control. And they're really gorgeous thanks to artwork by an amazing fan of the show named Catherine Rally, who designed them. Check them out and grab yours for a limited time at ChristyHarrison.com/swag. That's SWAG, which apparently stands for sealed with a gift. That's ChristyHarrison.com/swag. If you've found this podcast helpful, please help us reach more people who need to hear the anti-diet message by telling your friends and family to subscribe on Apple Podcasts or iTunes or your favorite podcast platform. And if you're looking for some practical tips to get started on your anti-diet journey, grab my free audio guide, 7 Simple Strategies for Finding Peace and Freedom with Food. Head over to ChristyHarrison.com/strategies to get it. That's ChristyHarrison.com/strategies. To get full show notes from this episode, including all the resources we discussed, go to ChristyHarrison.com/138 for episode 138. Food Psych is edited and engineered by Podcast Fast Track. Our administrative and community manager is Ashley Saruya, and our album art was photographed by Abby Moore Photography and designed by Meredith Noble. The music you're hearing behind me now is by a band called AWOL, and the track is called Food, used under their Creative Commons license. Thanks again for listening, and until next time, stay psyched. Stupid or scared, no work in the kitchen now. Who put you there in that perfect position?
and you ain't really beat. Have you ever went?